This evening, we're going to go ahead and try. Oh, I just lost everything there. All right, we're going to try and use these screens tonight. And so let's go ahead. If you want to take your songbook, you can turn to page 174, Faith is a Victory, or you can just look right there on the screen. Amen. All right. Why don't we all stand together and let's sing together. Page 174.
It camped along the hills of mighty Christian soldier tribes and crest of battle there the night amidst the glowing skies. Against the foes of hell below, let all our strength we hurl. Faith is a victory we know.
Victory,
oh glorious victory that overcomes.
Thank you. You can be seated. And wow, we made it. Amen. And it gets busy up here, though. But we're working on this. And of course, yesterday we were able to get everything up and hooked up. And this morning we've been working on it. And throughout the day we've been working on it. And so we're thankful that we have this opportunity to try something and develop our ministry a little bit further. So a couple things I want to just share with you. And, of course, be praying for some of our missionaries right now. And I like to bring our missionaries up. We'll be starting on March 26th, we'll be starting our Wings ministry once again. It meets once a month through the better weather months. We get longer daylight and less snow and ice, amen. And so it makes it easier for all of our ladies to come and be part of that ministry. So they'll meet again the end of March. And so as we, every week, we remind you of our missionaries, our Mahdi project in Uganda. You say, well, what is that? Well, in Uganda, there are many different dialects or languages, or several at least, and they're working on one called the Mahdi language. And so they've been in translation with that for several years now. And we're thankful to be helping to get the word of God out to a people in their own language. And what a blessing is going to be. You just think for hundreds of years now, 400 or 500 years, we've had the word of God in the English language. It's worked its way through, but we have the King James Bible at this point. But for all this time, while we've had the word of God, they haven't. And they don't know anything like we know about the Lord Jesus Christ, about God. And so we're praying that they will get that accomplished. Brother Josh Wormley in East Africa and Damon Matichiria in Zambia, Africa. And these are nations need to be reached. They've always been difficult for one reason or another. Many times it's because of the government and the instability in some of these nations where they can people can come in, Americans can come in and set up churches and works there. So it's been a ongoing progress, and there are millions of people just in that continent alone that need to be reached. We're thankful to be able to support some of those missionaries that are there right now, and continue to pray for the George Lilly family. George passed away last Thursday, so we'll be conducting a service tomorrow for him at the Dearth Funeral Home. There will be a viewing between 9 and 12 in the morning, and then I'll be conducting the service at 12 o'clock. And if you're not able to make it, just please be praying for the family. It's very hard and difficult. And George has had some difficulties, just mental difficulties, but he's a good man. And he had a hard life, but there are family that took him under their wings, loved him, took care of him. And today George is healthy. Everything's fine for him right now. And physically, mentally, every way, he's in great shape right now. We thank the Lord for heaven and for a church that cares about people and go out and reach individuals like this. So anyway, those are some of the things going on. Our soul winning this week will be Tuesday at 3:30. It looks like we're getting rain all week long, and we may get into it a little bit on Tuesday afternoon, but we'll be leaving here at 3:30. So let's just watch the weather and go out and take the gospel out. We saw one person saved 2 weeks ago, one person saved this past week. And you say, but it's just one. Why'd you waste the time? Because it's one. Because Jesus died for one. He died for, and all those ones make up millions and billions of people that Jesus died for. And so we're going to take the gospel out. If you're not able to join us, please remember us in prayer. Be praying for us. And it's so important that God's power is upon us as we talk to people. And some are not interested, some are. We just have to find out who the ones who are, and talk to them. And that's what's going on. Amen. That's going to be happening this week. We're going to go ahead and sing another congregational song, page 215, My Jesus, I Love You. And let's go ahead and stand together, and we'll sing this song together, My Jesus, I Love Thee.
My Jesus, I love thee. Thank you.
seated. At this time, we're going to take up our evening offering tonight. And so as we do, we'll have a word of prayer. And Brother Stillwagon, would you please lead us in a word of prayer tonight? If you need your songbooks, let's turn to page 481. And if not, just stand with me and we'll be singing the Till the Storm Passes Over.
In the dark of the midnight, I have lifted my face while the storm howls above me and there's no hiding place. In the crash of the storm, keep me safe, till the storm passes by. the sorrow, there's a home by and by. But I know thou art with me, and tomorrow I'll rise where the storm never darkens the skies. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky.
Let's take a moment and greet one another with a handshake. Stanza. When the long night has ended and the storms come no more, let me stand in thy presence on that bright, peaceful shore, in that land where the tempest never comes. Lord, may I dwell with thee when the storm passes by.
Thank you. Please take your Bibles as we're standing, and let's turn to the book of 2 Kings. All right, 2 Kings. We go into chapter 6. I'll begin reading in verse 7, and if you'll please follow along with me. And the sons of the prophets said unto Elisha, Behold, now the place where we dwell with thee is too strait for us. Let us go, we pray thee, unto Jordan, and take thence every man a beam. And let us make us a place there where we may dwell. And he answered, Go ye. And one said, Be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. So he went and went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they cut down wood. But as one was felling a beam, the axe head fell into the water, and he cried and said, Alas, master, for it was borrowed. And the man of God said, Where fell it? And he showed him the place, and he cut down a stick and cast it in thither, and the iron did swim. Therefore said he, Take it up unto thee, and he put it on his hand, and took it. Father, we thank you for this evening that we can be in church and your precious word. Lord, I just pray that you'll speak to each one of us tonight and how we need to hear from you, hear from heaven. And Lord, there are so many things in our life we need from you, and I pray that you'll help us, Father, to hear your voice when you speak to us. Bless the message, I pray tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated.
Chains were fastened tight down at the jail that night. Still, Paul and Silas would not be dismayed. They said, It's time to lift our voice, sing praises to the Lord. Let's prove that we will trust Him, come what may. God wants to hear you. Crashing round you when the fiery darts surround. when despair is all you see. God wants to hear your voice when the wisest man has spoken and says your circumstances as hopeless as can be. That's when God wants to hear you sing. He loves to hear our praise on our cheerful days when the pleasant times outweigh the bad by far. But when suffering comes along and we still sing him songs, that is when we bless the Father's heart. God wants to hear you sing when the waves are crashing round you, when the fiery darts surround you, when despair is all you see. God wants to hear your voice when the wisest man has spoken and says your circumstances as hopeless as can be. That's when God wants to hear you sing. God wants to hear you sing when the waves are crashing round you, when the fiery darts surround you, when despair is all you see. God wants to hear your voice when the wisest man has spoken and says your circumstances as hopeless as can be. That's when God wants to hear you sing.
God wants to hear you sing.
God wants to hear you sing. God wants to hear you sing.
Hey. Well, that's so true. When things are going good, it's easy to praise the Lord, but he wants us to praise him even in the dark and difficult days, and we find the goodness of God. We're looking at a story here concerning Elisha and the school of the prophets. A school of the prophets where Elisha was with them, and they had come to a point where they've grown out their facility where they're living at. And these men came, I imagine, as a place of training they came to, and they were in the process of rebuilding and going to a larger facility, building a larger place for themselves. And one of the prophets lost his axe head. As he's chopping wood, that axe head fell off. Maybe some of you understand what that's like. I know when I split wood, or I have in the past, I'd always have to keep an eye on that axe head because sometimes it wanted to loosen up, and I'd take it and take the handle of it and hit it on the ground and slide back on and tighten up. But apparently this man didn't do that type of thing. He became very distraught now because the axe head that he had was lost. It fell into the water. And he comes and cries to Elisha, that great prophet. And he performs a miracle. And the axe head floats now to the water, the surface. Can you imagine that? And the man puts his hand in there, picks out the axe head, and puts it back on his handle. Now, before we look at this guy and say, well, what a mess up he is. He lost his axe head, amen? And let's not be real harsh or critical on him, because one of the things we have to remember about him, he was busy. He was doing something. He is about a great work. You know, that'd be good if all of us could be about a great work and be busy for the Lord. We never have time to look at anybody else's flaw. I've watched people attempt things. I've watched them fail, but I've always encouraged them and been proud of them from a distance, if it were, because was there a noise? Everybody looked that way at one time, and it's like that. Everybody looked over there, and maybe a mouse ran by. I'm not sure. We'll have to keep an eye on things. But they're trying something. They're trying to do something for God. You know, the one who does nothing, he's trying to avoid criticism. He's trying to be under the radar, so to speak. He doesn't want anybody to look at him, because the criticism that they give, they may receive back. We have to be very careful about that. You know, if there is any flaw in this activity, I found in this that he was working and not watching. He was not paying attention to his instrument for the axe that he had,
there. And as a consequence, he lost that axe head and was unable to continue the work. He lost the cutting edge. I mean, he could have kept working, I imagine. Wouldn't have got very far with an axe handle, amen? I mean, you bruise a tree, beat a tree. Eventually, something's going to wear out. But I don't think he would have brought a tree down. Now, we may look at this story and wonder, what does this have to do with a lot of things, our life? Well, I believe there's a lot here that we can find. You see, the axe head, it represents the power to get the job done. You know, the handle wouldn't have helped. The man's arms weren't strong enough to take down a tree. He needed something beside himself that he had that would cut down that tree. You know, no man can just chop a tree down with the wrong instrument or no instrument at all. In the church, we need to always realize that without a cutting edge, without the power of the Holy Spirit on our life, we'll never be able to serve the Lord properly, nor will we be able to make a dent in this world. And that's what we want to do. We want to cause this world and shake it up. We want to cause a change in this world. I'm not talking about a revolution. I'm not talking about a riot or overthrowing the government like some people thought Jesus was trying to do. But by the way, Jesus was making an impact. Jesus was changing the world. But it wasn't through a revolution. It wasn't through an uprising. It was through the gospel of Jesus Christ and his own gospel that he is preaching and presenting to the world. And we need God, and we need to have his power to do anything we're going to do for his glory. You know, sadly, a lot of our churches in this modern day have turned away from, have lost the cutting edge. They forgot what it's all about. It's interesting because there are plenty of things in life that you can find flawed. People you can find flawed. Churches you can find flawed. And I'm sorry to say there's been a younger generation that's come up behind us and have looked at all the flaws of the independent fundamental Baptist church. They said, well, they're flawed here and they're flawed there. Now, yes, they spoke of these things, I believe, that were human. Well, that preacher was mean. Well, that's human. Well, they're this or they're that. But what they fail to see is the truth that we hold, the Word of God that we hold, the power that is in the Holy Spirit in Christ. And now they've distanced themselves. They don't want to be named Baptist. They want to be a church, but we have Baptist doctrine, but they remove a great part, an important part of that doctrine, and I'll not get into that tonight, but they remove that great part of the doctrine the independent fundamental Baptist churches had that made us different, set us apart, and God used us during that period of time. And we're not careful, we could end up losing the cutting edge. You say, well, Pastor, there's not a lot of people like us anymore. It's not as popular anymore, and there's no great conferences that we can attend and go to any longer. And boy, things have changed. Maybe the culture has changed. Maybe the way we do things must change also. And I'm against that because I believe the only change we need is to get back to depending upon the Holy Spirit and depending upon him to get the job done instead of trying to do it in our own power and our strength. You say, but Pastor, I'm busy, my work schedule. I don't have time to seek God. I don't have time to pray. I don't have time to seek the Holy Spirit. And if I do, it's very brief. It's not very long at all. You know, we can operate as a church like many do. We can develop new programs and say that's the answer. But our lives apart from God will never make any inroads into this world apart from the power of God. And we'll never be able to serve the Lord in an effective manner until we have the power of the Lord upon our life. This passage is a story that talks to us about how to regain that power. Now, I want us to notice here tonight, it involves several steps in recovering this edge. First of all, we notice in verse 5, it involves concern. You say, Pastor, what is this talking about? Well, in verse 5, it says, but as one was felling the beam, the axe head fell into the water, and he cried and said, alas, Master, for it was borrowed. All of a sudden, there was concern. The power that he had was gone. The ability to make a change was gone. The ability to build something was gone.
and take down that beam. As soon as this man felt that axe head fly off the handle, he cries out in despair because something is gone now. And the first step for anyone, any church, any individual, to recovering the power of the Spirit of God is coming to the place when we realize we don't have it. We don't have it. I am convinced that many people walk through this life thinking they have the filling of the Holy Spirit when they have lost the power and don't even realize it, don't even know that it's gone. They're trying to live for God and to do His work in the power of their own humanity, in the power of their own flesh, and His power, God's power, is nowhere wrong. They don't even realize it's gone any longer. Why? Well, I got a Sunday school outline. I know how to do it. I make my visits. I know how to do that. I know I can call them, or I can text them, or I can stop by. I know how to go through this. I know how to do it. I know how to sit in church and listen to a sermon. No, that's not it. And fall asleep. But no, I'm just teasing. But, you know, we have this idea that we've done this so long. I've been a Christian a long time, like many of you have. Decades. And there was a time in our life we looked and we were making a change in this world. We were affecting the world we live in. But now that effect is not taking place any longer. Now, we can go back and say, well, it's COVID's fault as long as we want to. And we say, well, it all changed then. It all happened then. Yeah, it did. There are some things that did change. But the church didn't have to change with it. The church didn't have to lose its power like it did. The church can have its power once again. The condition, as I said, in many of these modern-day churches now is that really they rival the Laodicean period, when they were thought they were rich, but they were poor. They thought they had all these things, but they really didn't have anything at all any longer. Look, where are the two or three together in my name? And He is in the midst of them. The Spirit of the Lord, He's in us. There's no doubt about that. That's His promise. And when we show up at church, He shows up at church. I'm not talking about in His mere presence. I'm talking about in a manifest presence. I believe that we walk in the power. Our life, walking in, will be a testimony. It will be a testimony. I'm trying to think right now of the great revivalist, Charles G. Finney. And Charles Finney is used during the 1700s in the first, they say, called the Great Awakening that happened in America. And Charles Finney was known for being a powerful preacher. And in fact, many people were turning to Christ and revival was happening during that time. The Bible says that he walked into a factory, not the Bible, I'm sorry, his biography says he walked into a factory one time. It was a factory, a sewing factory. And we're talking about people on sewing machines and doing all the work by hand. And he walked in, people noticed him, and machines started to stop. They looked at him. And there was one particular lady. She was trying to thread the needle to her machine, and she was getting nervous because Brother Finney was walking through the plant. And when he walked in, she recognized her sinfulness just by his presence, because he is known for being a godly man. And she fell down finally on the floor and cried out to the Lord for repentance. You say, well, what did Charles Finney have to do with that? That's what a life is like. I'm not saying that you and I would walk down the street and people will fall at our feet and say, Lord, I want to get saved. But people will know your testimony. And those people knew his testimony. They heard about him. They read about him. They may even heard him preach. They knew he was a godly man. And his godliness affected their life because they were ungodly. And they walked in and they weren't just saying, well, old Dale's got religion over there, or old Dale's a Christian now, don't say that and curse in front of them, and ha, 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 and pardon my French, ha, 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 and I know I shouldn't say this, but they say it anyways, ha, ha, ha. You know, it goes beyond that. It goes beyond a godly life that people know. And you walk into your church and you walk in spirit-filled as a godly individual. You walk through your life and people recognize your holiness of your life. You're walking around. You're not out there with a sign, a sandwich sign, like the fellow on the corner down here saying, I am holy. I am filled with the Spirit of God. That's not what it's all about. I'm talking about the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. But this also not only involves concern, it involves confession.
In verse 5, again, it speaks about this, for it was borrowed, it was never mine. That axe head was never mine. The man realized it was gone now. He immediately told Elijah what had happened. He confessed the fact that he lost it. He didn't just hide, didn't stop working. He said, I lost it. And by admitting the axe head was gone, he was also admitting the fact that it had become loose and he had not bothered to tighten it. After we discover that we are lacking something, we must come to the place where we admit that the lack, that lack to the Lord and really to one another in our life. And that, this is not an easy thing to say when we want to feel like we got everything together, like my life is on a road and smooth sailing and nothing's going to bother it. But unless we realize that something's missing, something's missing. My father years ago told me a story. He was a truck driver, and he and another fellow were in a truck making deliveries, and Brother Pace, I don't know if this ever happened to you. You probably heard stories about this. But they're driving along, and they watched some guy's tire go flying past them. They thought it was so funny. They start laughing and say, look at that guy's tire went flying by. They didn't realize it came off their own truck until the truck went down, you know, and lost a tire out there. They never recognized, laughing at the tire going by, that it was their tire. That it was their tire. One time he told me a story. He said, in the old days, they had canvas tarps. At that time, my father smoked, and a lot of the men did that day. And well, they were driving down the road, and they don't have a problem in the world. They got a tarp covering up all the tile flooring they're going to deliver. It's going to be installed, and one of the men took their cigarette, threw it out the window, landed on that tarp. We were driving down the road thinking everything's fine. Heading to the next job, whole back of the truck is on fire. All the tiles melting, everything's on fire. People are waving, finally got them stopped, and they finally got the fire put out. But we live our life. Those are the kind of funny stories I thought they were. My dad told them to me, and I still think they are. But, you know, we go through life, and we look at some and say, look at that pitiful people over there. Look at that fake Christianity. Look at that church over there. They're not the right kind of church. They shouldn't be doing that. Look at those ungodly churches over there, and they don't even preach a true gospel over there. And look at them. But we live our life failing to see what's empty in our life. We fail to see what's not there in our life. You know, we say, all this is good and this is all good doctrine, but what does it mean to us? Let me ask you something. Do you talk to anybody about the Lord? Do you know when they need to get saved? You know they need to be a witness. But who is it you're praying for? What family member? What person you know in your life, what person you work with or shop store, and you look at them and you say, I'm going to pray for that person. I'm going to be an influence on that person. I'm going to go after that person. You know, what are we doing? It's good to, we think it's good to look at people and say what they're not doing. But what are we doing? We lose the power of God. We lose the interest in what God wants. We lose his influence and we look around not even realizing it's gone. Where are the honest hearts that will cry out and say, Lord, I don't have the fire like I used to have. I'm not as close to you as I used to be. I need the power of God upon my life to get the job done, to live my life for my children, for my family, for my friends, for my church. You know, he already knows. He already knows where we're at. But he wants us to come to the realization that we lost something. We don't have what we used to have. And we say, well, all the great preachers are gone. All the great churches are gone. Well, all the great this is gone. All that is gone. And it is. They lived their time on earth. Their time ended. They're in heaven today. But what are we doing? We experienced that. We knew that. You say, is it ever going to come back again? Well, if you're waiting for somebody to bring it in on a U-Haul truck and drag it up the front steps and bring it into the church, you're sadly mistaken, because it's going to happen by the people of God getting the power of God upon their lives and not just waiting for something to happen around us. We live our life and nothing ever changes. Nothing's ever different. And we've got to look at that and realize some things in our life. Look, before we ever lose this cutting edge, as individuals and as a church, we must first come to a place where we can honestly admit that we can't do it, but God can. It also involves comprehension. One of the reasons the man is so upset is because the axe head didn't even belong to him.
He had borrowed it from someone in order to work on the building. Now losing the axe head may not seem like that big of a deal to you and me. You know, we can ride to the store and pick up another one. They have them down there. We can just buy another one. However, tools back in that time were made of iron, and that was a very scarce supply. This is illustrated when we see the story in 1 Samuel chapter 13 and verse 22. It tells us there, it talks about having only a sword in the land. Not a lot of swords, but there's a sword in the land. That was it. And plus the fact that it was a borrowed tool would require this man to replace the axe head, which he obviously couldn't do since he had to borrow it in the first place. The fact that a person would lend this tool of such value was a sign of the owner of the axe head trusted that young prophet. And he didn't want him to violate that trust. When we are working for the Lord, as we should be operating in borrowed power. We don't have power. Not the kind to do the work of God. We don't have that kind of power. And some may have power in business and authority over others, in companies and manufacturing, and maybe even in government and politics. But to do the work of God, man doesn't have the natural power to do that. It only comes by God. It only comes by His Spirit upon us. See, therefore, we must be especially careful with that power entrusted to us and never take it for granted. I've heard it said, and I've heard it taught, and I believe it. We ought to be asking for the power of God every day in our life. You say, did you lose it somewhere? You better keep asking for it. You might lose it somewhere. You might forfeit it somewhere in your life. But we don't want to ever lose it. May we never come to the place where we act as though nothing can take that power away from us, because it's only God. They gave it to us, and God can take it away. Look, if we're going to serve the Lord, if we're going to see some eternal results, which I want, and I want our church to be able to do that, I want you to be able to do that. I want you to be able to stand before the Lord and know that your life impacted this world and brought souls to Christ and souls into heaven. When this whole world is all said and done, the rapture takes place, and God brings a judgment down upon this world like it's never known and never seen and never will know until it happens, that we get to heaven and we've done something different. We've not walked the normal walk. We've not followed the emerging church. We've not followed the contemporaries. But we follow the Lord Jesus Christ, and we found the power that only He can grant us. And we did something with that power. And souls are turned to heaven and come to heaven. And we take that power as a teacher and an influencer. And we talk to that person. Maybe it's in your home. Maybe it's your own children. Maybe it's a family member. But we take that influence, that power, and we use it to help their life and affect them for eternity. You know, we need that power that only comes from above. It doesn't come from anywhere else. But this also involves coming back. Notice in verse 6. And the man of God said, "Where fell it?" And he showed him a place, and he cut down a stick and cast it in thither, and the iron did swim. It's an interesting word that he asked here. Where'd it fall off at? Where'd you lose it? And he called the prophet back to the place where the axe head was lost. And before it can be recovered, they had to go to the place where it had fallen. And before you and I can recover the power of God in our lives and in our church, we must return to the place where we lost that power. What took you out of the work of God? What took you out of your prayer life seeking Him? What took you away from being that voice of a witness in this world? What happened? Where did it start? Where did it all begin? Where did that point come where you made that turn in your life, that intersection in your life? We must uncover the reason why the power has been forfeited. Is it because of some sin that we have committed in our life? Is it because our priorities have become misplaced? Is it because we're guilty of trusting the arm of the flesh instead of the power of the Holy Spirit? Where did we lose that power? Where was it when we lost it?
Where was that place? If we're honest this evening, we may all be able to pinpoint areas of our life that stand between us and having the glorious power of God upon our life once again. And we need to go back and backtrack to discover where that was. Go back in our mind. Go back where it was, where we wandered off course. We need to go back to that point and make a course of correction in our life again. And when we do, we can prepare for the glory and the return of God in our lives. You know, folks, I was talking to someone today, and they were talking about someone is out of church, and they became so disappointed with people. They became so disappointed with their Christian at church, and then outside of church, they're just whatever they are. They came to a point and said, if this is Christianity, why do I want to keep going? Why do I want to continue in this? Let me ask you a question. Did that happen to you? Did you look at someone and say, if that's what Christianity is, I'm not getting involved anymore? Let me tell you right now, Christianity isn't the man. Christianity is Christ. And you and I have to get our eyes off people that have failed us and put our eyes back on Christ, who we were looking at, who we were praying to and serving and depending on and loving. Then we looked at someone else and we said, you know, they're a better Christian than I am, and they've messed things up. Let me say something right now. You don't know who the better Christian is. You don't know who the better Christian is. You may be the better Christian than the one you're looking at. And we're not to compare ourselves among ourselves, because the Bible says that's not wise. And so to look at somebody and say, that's a great Christian over there, we don't really know that. They're doing a great work, maybe. They have great things are happening. We see that. But we ought to be serving the Lord because of the Lord, not because of man. Look, I've faced a lot of disappointments and those I've looked up to through the years, through the decades. You probably have too. But I'll tell you right now, that never deterred me from serving Christ. It hurt. It set me back a little bit, maybe. It confused me a little bit. But I always got refocused on, I'm doing this because of Christ. I'm not doing that because of this great man of God or this college I went to or that preacher over there or that individual over there. I never want to live my life that way. I never kept my eyes. Now, men were good examples to me. And yes, I did look up to some as good examples to me. And I want to follow them and emulate some of the things they're doing in Christ's work. But when they fell, I was very clear in realizing that they're flesh. If Satan's going to attack, is he going to attack the guy doing nothing at all? Is the football player going to attack the guy sitting on the bench and jump up and thump his chest and do their dance out there, high-five one another? Tackle the guy on the bench. Well, he wasn't even in the game. No, Satan's not after the guy on the bench. He's after the guy in the game. He's after the Christian doing something. That's who he's going after. He's after, you know, a lot of times in a ball game, football game, if you can knock a quarterback out, boy, you've done yourself a great service the rest of the game. You don't want to hurt him bad. You want to hurt him enough just to get him out of the game. Hurt his hand, break a finger. Man, it's not a big deal in football. And hurt their knee or something. Got to go out of the game. Then the second string or the third string guy comes in, and they know they have a great, better chance of winning that game. They got him out. When you're in any kind of leadership, you have a responsibility, a junior church, a bus route, a Sunday school class, a greeter at the door, a nursery worker in the nursery. You say that. Now, let me tell you something. God, there's a battle, and the devil's going to try and attack those people and tear them down. You say, well, they thought they were all this. They were saying, follow me and do this. And now they fell. Well, they had an enemy going after them. And my friend, pray for them. Don't get down on them, because if you were in the battle, it could have been you also. If you were in the game, not on the bench, you could have been the one getting ramshackled and tackled, whatever that means, and beat up on the side and taken out of the game. It could have been you. And so I'm afraid. Young generation, put their eyes on men, found them fallible. Old Christians got discouraged at looking at man and just stepped off to the side. We lost our power somewhere. I believe that's a big part of it right there. You stay in Christian life long enough, you're going to face a lot of disappointments. Oh, you're going to face a lot of them. How many times have I had somebody come to the church and say, this is it. This is Mecca. This is the place where I want to be. I want to join the church now. I say, wait a week or two. Wait a week or two. I'm ready to join the church now. I want to get involved. I want to be this and that. And I want to, oh, this is home. And they join the church and the pastor never sees them again on earth. Man, I'm tired of getting disappointed. I'm tired of all the promises people gave me they're going to come to church. I'm tired of all the promises that I hear all the time. Oh, Lord, I'm so disappointed. People just disappoint me. I'm just going to retire. I'm going to go make some money and live out my life. Or I'm going to realize I didn't do it for that excited person visiting the church and joining it and never coming back again. I'm not going to do it because of promises made by people that will fail. I'm not going to be disappointed in that. Because I want to live my life for Christ. Where are we losing our power at? Where are we walking away from God at and giving everything up? Look, this also involves a confrontation also. In verse 6, you know, we notice here Elijah's response to the situation is to cut down a tree and cast it into the water. When he does, the axe head floats back to the surface again and a miracle occurs. When human means are abandoned, and divine help is sought, miracles happen. I've never seen a piece of iron swim before in my life. Never seen a 5-pound or whatever the weight, 3-pound axe head just come back up to the surface and say, here I am. No, they're in the bottom of the deep abyss, amen, somewhere in the mud. You never find it again. But this, something happened here. Something took place. You know, we come to the place where we acknowledge the loss of the cutting edge in our life. There is only one way to get it back. There must be a confrontation with the divine. I'm talking about coming before God ourselves. First, there must be a tree involved. That tree I'm referring to is the cross of Jesus Christ. Realizing that He is our Savior. That He died for us. When we get serious about dealing with our sins and our shortcomings, we realize He's on that cross because of what I've done. And we get serious to start dealing with that, the Lord will respond with forgiveness and restoration. Then there must be a total abandonment of all human agency and all human power. Trusting in a stick to make the axe head float sounds like a crazy deal. Brother Rick called me up and said, car fell in the lake. Well, I can get that car back. I'll throw a stick in and it'll float back up. Say, Pastor, you are nuts. And you have every right to say I'm nuts, amen? Because I'm not going to make that stick go into there. It's not going to help it float. But God can make miracles happen. And we come to Him, and we confess our sins. And you say, well, I'm not an awful sinner. Look, every sin we commit is an awful sin. It put Jesus on the cross. See, I'm not bad like those other people. We're just bad enough to put Jesus on the cross where He has to die for us. We sin just enough to go to hell, though, forever. You see, I just told a lie. That's all it takes. I just took something away. That's all it takes. I just had a little bit of pride. That's all it takes to go to hell. And Jesus came and died for us. So it's that little things that we say are insignificant. They're probably the things that are dragging us away from Him. Look, we've got to stop trying to do the work of the Lord and come back to Him. Look, one of the first primary steps to recovering the cutting edge of power in the church is return to the altar of God. Somebody just told me, a pastor in a certain church in town said, what's a phrase? It's the altar call is the work of the devil. Is that what I heard? It's the work of the devil. I'm thinking, well, how can it be the work of the devil? In the Old Testament, they set up altars all the time for God.
They set up a pile of rocks, so this is an altar to God, and they knelt down and met God there and prayed there. Now, these foolish people out there are making foolish statements, and they don't know what they're talking about at all. But the thing is, we have to have an altar somewhere. It might be in your closet. When Jesus made a reference to go to your closet to pray, it's just a reference of getting alone with him. It may be a place you have to set that altar up. It may be very right here in this very church becomes your altar. When we come to a place where we acknowledge the loss, it's the only way we're going to get it back. We've got to stop trying to do all the work of God and ourselves and take a step back and realize that we need to put our trust in him. One of the primary steps of recovering that edge is that altar. And when the church deals with her sins, that way, between us and the Lord, it gets cleared of all obstructions. You can count on the return of the power of God in our churches and in our lives. But also involves a commitment. We notice in verse 7, said, therefore, said he, take it up to thee. And he put it in his hand and took it. The last thing this young man did was reach down to the water and took that axe head in his hand. He committed to receiving by faith that which the Lord had done. And this may be the end of the story as far as the Bible record is concerned right here. But we can be sure of what happened next. That young man firmly reattached that axe to the handle, that axe head to the handle. He went back to chopping down that tree. And whatever other trees he needed down, he took that axe head to it. He recovered the cutting edge and was able to do what needed to be done. God has power available to all who will pay the price for it. And you say, what price? What am I going to have to sacrifice? You're going to have to sacrifice your pride. And become humble. This is his work, it's not ours. I say, this is my church I'm pastoring. This is my church. It's not my church. It's Christ's. I didn't die for you, he did. Not my Sunday school class, not my bus route, his. Now, we use those terms. I'm not against those terms. But we were to have it set in our mind and in our heart that this is all God's. If we're going to do everything or anything for God, we're going to get it back. We've got to pay a price of humbling ourselves to come before him and seeking him, seeking that power that only he can give. And by the way, if we're going to get that power, there's got to be some junk kicked out of our lives, some sin in our lives, some things that are preventing that power to come to us. And maybe it's a schedule. I don't know. It could be as simple as that. God has power for all those who will come to him. But when we come to that place where we are simply tired of the same old, same old, the same old, same old, and we're willing to handle our loss of the cutting edge in God's manner, he will give us back the power to do his work his way. You say, well, it's the same repetition every week. Why does it have to be? Why does it have to be? Why can't someone be coming to church because we influence them with power? Why can't somebody be getting saved and coming to church because we influence them with power? Why can't our classes be growing because we've influenced them with the power that Christ has given us? We say, well, this reason and that reason. I'm going to tell you right now, God is in control of building his church. You and I are. But we're responsible for getting his power on our life. And we ought to be doing the work and making a difference in this old world instead of just going through the motions of life. Look, where is the cutting edge this evening at Bible Baptist Church? Where is that cutting edge? For most of it, it's at the bottom of a river somewhere, totally beyond our reach and beyond our ability to recover it. But can we get that back? Yes, we can. Very clearly, the Bible tells us that. But it will take some steps to come there and to get to that place this evening. The first step and the second step, and it's getting there before the Lord and dealing with the problem his way, not our way. Say, well, I'm kind of busy. I don't have this. Let me tell you something right now. It's going to be shocking to us when God says our busyness was our sin. Our schedule was our sin. And we say, I couldn't help it. And God says, that's your sin. That's it right there. But Lord, I did all these other things, but you're too busy to do what I want you to do. Why? Schedule them out. My company made me. Now, I don't know all the situations every company, but I know we have a God in charge of everything. When Daniel was in prison, they wanted him to eat of the king's meat. And that violated dietary laws for the Jews. He persuaded the jailer to bring to him fruit and vegetables instead of the king's dietary meat. He said, prove me 10 days and see if not healthier and fatter than the others. And he proved him 10 days, but he was able to persuade a jailer who was his captive, a captor. And he persuaded him to say, well, I can't talk to my boss. Well, I think Daniel went to prayer first. And God did some miraculous things. God did some wonderful things. And we need to put him on top and saying, well, it's out of my control. I'll tell you, it will always be out of your control until you pray, until you seek the Lord, until you get answers to prayer, until things start happening because you fell on your face before God and he changed that man's heart, that woman's heart, whoever it is in your life that's making your schedules up, that's making your life difficult, whatever it is, we need to get back to God and trusting God wholeheartedly in this matter. You know, we need to get back to that cutting edge, folks, individually and as a church. Let's bow our heads, please. Every head bowed and every eye closed here tonight. The Lord probably has something for all of us here this evening. And Father, I ask you right now to, Lord, help us. Help us to see, have our eyes open to see the need in our life, the need in our church, and Father, may you give us thy power. We know thy spirit, your spirit lives within us. And Lord, we've not yielded to him. His power is not working through us. We're not making the difference you want us to make in this world. But Father, help us to have a hungry heart for you. And to have what we remember in years gone by we had, and Father, it's available, I know, today. Please speak to each one of us. Open our eyes. Humble us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand as our organist plays tonight. And if God has spoken to you in any way tonight, I want you to take a few minutes at this old-fashioned altar. Just come down to him. Meet with him, whether it's on the front pew, whether it's at the steps. All right, you can look this way. How many went that year to pastor school
maybe it was 1980. I'm not sure when Brother Hiles preached on the Holy Spirit and the power of God. How many were at that? Did you go to that? And Daryl, were you at that one there? You were there at that one? And I was told that the emphasis on this very thing here is so strong and so powerful, and people left brokenhearted seeking him. And he said, always have something. He suggested put something on your mirror when you're shaving in the morning. Not you, ladies, the men. And, men don't shave half the time anymore. But just pray for power. Throughout the day, just pray for power. You know, put on your sun visor, put it wherever, and just a little note, pray for power. Apparently, they had, when you walked out the building, they had stickers that said, pray for power, turn face down. And when you walked out, they were stuck on the bottom of your shoes. So you crossed your foot and they have pray for power. They did a lot of little clever things there, made you think about that. And you know, there was a day, that time, that era, where churches all across America were seeking the Lord and seeking his power. And that's when we look at those days and say, all these churches were just growing and building and people were excited. And that's something that only God can do. And man, we cannot create that energy in any other way. There's something that's very supernatural about the energy that God brings into a life and God brings into a church. And if we will seek him and seek that power, we just might very well see that energy come back again and God do some great things. Let's go ahead and close on page 21 of our songbook, the chorus, Sweet, Sweet Spirit. Let's go ahead and close with that chorus and we'll be dismissed for tonight.
Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet heavenly dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. For all these blessings, we lift our heart in praise. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall believe.